முதலாவது பேச்சாளர் என்ற முதலாவது இவர் மைசூர் பல்கலைக்கழகத்தில் வரலாறு மற்றும் தொல்லியல் துறையிலிருந்து முனைவர் பட்டம் பெற்றவர்கள். இவங்களுக்கு குறிப்பாக சொல்ல இவங்களுடைய மூணு துறையில் இவங்களுடைய ஈடுபாடு ரொம்ப ஆழ்ந்த ஈடுபாடு ஜாஸ்தி. கட்டுமானம் ஆர்கிடெக்சர், படிமவியல் ஐக்கனோகிராஃபி, கல்வெட்டியல் எபிகிராஃபி, இந்த மூணு துறையிலையும் இவங்க ஷி ஹஸ் டன் டீப் ரிசர்ச் அண்ட் ஸ்டடி. பல புத்தகங்களை எழுதியிருக்கிறார். குறிப்பாக சொல்ல வேண்டுமென்றால் விஷ்ணு டெம்பிள்ஸ் ஆஃப் சவுத் இந்தியா நான்கு பாகங்களாக எழுதிய புத்தகம், புத்தகத்தொடர். அப்புறம் ஹிஸ்ட்ரி அண்ட் கல்ச்சர் ஆஃப் தமிழ்நாடு இரண்டு பாகங்களாக எழுதிய புத்தகம். பழந்தமிழகத்தில் சமஸ்கிருத கல்வியும் இலக்கியமும் அதை பற்றியும் புத்தகம் எழுதியிருக்காங்க. தக்ஷின் சித்ரா, கலாட்சேத்ரா ஃபவுண்டேஷன், ஆசிய இதழியல் கல்லூரி போன்ற நிறுவனங்களில் சிறப்பு விரிவுரையாளராக பணியாற்றி வருகிறார். மிகச்சிறந்த பேச்சாளர், அவங்களுடைய பேச்சை நான் நிறைய தடவை கேட்டிருக்கேன். தத்தலோகா அரங்கில் வந்து அவங்க டெம்பிள்ஸ் இன் அண்ட் அரவுண்ட் சென்னை அப்படிங்கிற ஒரு தலைப்பில் ஒரு தொடர் பேச்சு நிகழ்ச்சி நடத்தினாங்க. அது மட்டும் இல்லாமல் வேறு நிறைய நிகழ்ச்சியிலையும் அவங்க பேசி கேட்டிருக்கேன். அவங்களுடைய பேச்சு கேட்ட ஒரு அனுபவத்தில் நான் சொல்கிறேன், அவங்க எந்த இடத்த பற்றி பேசினாலும் அந்த இடத்துக்கே நேரடியாக கூட்டி செல்லக்கூடிய ஒரு ஆற்றல் படைத்தவர். அவ்வளோ ஒரு அற்புதமான பேச்சாற்றல் படைத்தவர்கள் முனைவர் சித்ரமாதவன் அவர்களை இப்போது மேடை கழிக்கிறேன்.
A very good morning, friends. At the outset, I would like to thank the Tamil Heritage Trust and Tamil Virtual Academy for inviting me to be part of this series of talks. My heartfelt thanks to Professor Swaminathan and to his dedicated group of volunteers of the Tamil Heritage Trust. I know of the good work that you're all doing in propagating knowledge of places of historical interest and the tours that you're undertaking for this cause. It's a very important cause. It sometimes seems to me, from the little work that I am doing, sometimes it's very depressing and I think of it as a lost cause. But time and again, we get some confidence from the little patches of sunlight that we see when some small school child comes and says, I came for your talk or I attended your lecture, and then they tell me something from what he or she has heard, then you think there is a ray of hope somewhere. We'll keep at it. I'm sure there will be some light at the end of the tunnel. We desperately need to showcase our heritage and culture. There is this place called Mamallapuram, about 50 kilometers from Chennai. 99.9% of the people in Chennai will call it Mahabalipuram, or they'll call it Mahabs. It hurts. It really hurts because this is the cradle. This is where it all started. This is where you see everything that should be seen in temple art and architecture. And Mahabs, I'm afraid, is not quite the name that we should be assigning this UNESCO World Heritage Site. The rest of the world seems to know about it. We in Chennai don't. And we have to rectify that wrong. And what better effort than this, organized by these two academies. The title given to me is of a survey of Mamallapuram. This is, in a way, very easy to do because the speakers who are going to be after this will all be concentrating on one restricted topic. So it's easy. So it's also very difficult because then you don't know what to focus on, and it's just going to be a very superficial bird's eye view. Also difficult because 1 hour is simply not enough to cover all the monuments, that also. But I'll try to do what I can. I'm not going to be able to cover all the sites here, certainly not. But we'll see what we can do. Can I request the lights to be switched off, please? It's also nice to see the Chola sponsoring a seminar on the Pallavas. Okay, we'll go straight to Varaha cave. Oh, let me start from the very beginning, which is a very good place to start. We know of the Pallavas, and the Pallavas, apparently, according to most historians, were the successors of the Satavahana dynasty that ruled over the Deccan. And they seem to have come into the Tamil area, the northern part of Tamil Nadu, which is famously known as Tondai Nadu or Tondai Mandalam, approximately in the 5th century. The earliest inscriptions of the Pallavas were not in stone, they were on copper plate documents, and they even have Prakrit charters with the Brahmi script. And then later, Sanskritam came. And the Grantha, the famous Pallava Grantha script also came into being. And then the Tamil inscriptions also followed. The one name that we really must remember as far as the Pallavas are concerned with regard to art and architecture and sculpture is Mahendravarman I. I know there are major scholars in this audience. I also know that there are people who have done immense work on Mamallapuram here. This is a disclaimer that I'm giving right at the outset. My lecture is aimed at the people who are not scholars and who have not done any intensive research with regard to Mamallapuram. Okay, makes me feel far more comfortable now. And so Mahendravarman Pallava, who came to the throne around 600 and ruled till 630 AD, was a pioneer in the Pallava Vamsha as far as art and architecture was concerned. I am not showing you any of the photographs because of time constraints in of his cave temples in other parts of Tamil Nadu, but his very, very famous inscription in Sanskritam in Mandakapattu reads like this: Etad anishtikam adrumam aloham ashudam vichitra chittena nirvapitam nirpena brahmeshwara vishnu lakshita yatanam. Quite simply stating that he, Vichitra Chitta, made temples without brick, without mortar, without metal, and without wood. And that he was making temples out of stone, which was nothing very new, because the Chalukyas to the north and in as early as Ashoka's reign, they had done it in places like Bihar, and the Pandyas down south had already done it. But in Tondai Mandalam, in the area in which he was ruling, he was the pioneer in making cave temples out of stone. Having said that, the person who really brought cave temples to the level that we are going to see today was his son and successor, Narasimhavarman I, better known as Mamalla, most of whose cave temples we see in Mamallapuram and in Mamallapuram alone. But how old is this place that we are going to see? We have, this is the birthplace of Buddha Tarvar, one of the first Arvars, the Mudal Arvars, whom historians would date to 5th or 6th centuries AD. And Buddha Tarvar's Pashurams, his Tamil hymns on the Stalashayana Perumal in Mamallapuram are there. I'm sure that's going to be dealt with in tomorrow's lecture, so I won't delve into that too deeply. Following him, Thirumangai Arvar in the 8th century came to this place, Mamallai or Kadalmallai, and also sang about Stalashayana Perumal. And the amount of light they throw, not only on the god, but on this entire area, is something very fascinating. We shouldn't think of the Devaram and the Divya Prabandham hymns as only to do with God. Yes, of course, they are religious works, but much more can be gleaned from them, of history, of geography, of the kind of places these were. It's all very important. And this was a place that was frequented by Greek and Roman traders. This was a seaport. But before Buddha Tarvar, much before Thirumangai Arvar, that is before the 5th and 6th centuries AD, approximately in the 1st century AD, we have a work of the Tamil Sangam period called the Perumba Natru Padai, which mentions Tondaiman Ilan Thirayan, a very great chieftain who ruled over the Tondai Mandalam area with Kanchipuram as his capital city. And this work mentions a port town which could only be Mamallapuram. It mentions a lighthouse, etc. I'm just touching upon these points. Now, there are controversies and controversies as far as Mamallapuram is concerned, and deservedly so, because there are no clear-cut epigraphical details telling us who exactly made this temple, who exactly built that temple, etc. So it's more conjecture. We really don't know who did it, and this has given rise to many, many controversies. I won't go into it. I'll only say that many historians and archaeologists, other scholars, have in the past thought that most of the monuments of Mamallapuram belong to the time of Mamalla, the title given to Narasimhavarman the First Pallava, the son of Mahendravarman the First. There are also a group of scholars who would assign most of the monuments in Mamallai to Rajasimha, the title of Narasimhavarman the Second, who was the builder of the Shore Temple and the temples in Kanchipuram like the Kailasanatha Temple. With that, I won't go further into this controversial issue because I have also not done very intensive research on Mamallapuram. My predecessors, greater scholars, have done great work on this. And all that I'm going to do today is to be quoting from them and not much of my own at all. So here we are going into the Varaha Cave Temple. Idha kuda anichirulame. We go to the Varaha Cave Temple that is here. Whether it's Narasimhavarman the First or Narasimhavarman the Second, we won't bother about it. It's just that we just notice what the pillars are coming into their own. Mahendravarman's caves do not have pillars like this. This is the famous Simha Pada. Pada as in leg. Pada, Pada, both in Sanskritam are feet or leg. And this lion starts coming in from the 7th century AD. Now, this is the temple as we see it today, and we can understand that the whole of it is one piece of rock. It's a cut-in cave temple, and the steps here, the steps there, just see the alignment. You can see it all your life and not stop admiring it. Just keeps going and like that. How identical these two pillars are, who made it, what was his name, we have absolutely no idea. The names of the architects and sculptors, nothing is given over here. We go straight into the Garbhagriha, into the sanctum, and we find that is empty. And that leads us into thinking, who was this for? Was it for Shiva? Was it for Vishnu? Because on one side, this is called the Varaha Cave Temple. It doesn't mean there was Varaha inside. Possibly yes, possibly no, we are not to say. But there's a Varaha sculpture here, we'll come to that. There's a Lakshmi here, there's a Durga here, there's a Trivikrama, Ulahalanda Perumal here. So who was this for? And if it was there, what was it? How was he? Was it of stone? If it was stone, why is it not there now? Or was it stucco? Was it Sudai? And has it disintegrated over the many centuries? Or was it a painting that was there on the back wall? That kind of worship was also allowed. Was it there? And did it also disintegrate? Questions, 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 and no answers. Marg, about 10 years ago, brought out a DVD on Mamallapuram with a commentary by the famous scholar, Dr. Vidya Deheja of Columbia University. And the title was, I thought, most fitting, most apt. It was called The Riddle in the Sands. It's a riddle. It's a riddle. The questions are there, but we have no answers. For each and every one of these monuments, perhaps excepting the Shore Temple and a few others, the questions are just hanging there in the air and we don't have the proper answers. And those scholars who think they do have the answers are again questioned. So here was this sculpture, the main image, and we don't know old photographs of this temple. So the K.R. Srinivasan's book on Pallava monuments clearly states that in all likelihood it was Vishnu, because Vishnu temples are guided by two codes, two agamas. One would be the Pancharatra agama and the other would be the Vaikhanasa agama. Till today, all the Vishnu temples, especially in Tamil Nadu, are guided according to these two sets of rules. It's one or the other. So, according to the Vaikhanasa agama, on to this side of the main sanctum should be Lakshmi and to the other side of the main sanctum should be Durga, which is exactly how it is over here. So, in all likelihood, it was Vishnu, but what type of Vishnu, who it was in there, and what form, what, whether it was stone or stucco or a painting, I'm afraid we may never know unless some inscription suddenly surfaces from somewhere. So the Dwarapalakas are there. They very clearly seem to be Vishnu Dwarapalakas from an identification given in several books, though it is not clear over here. This is the chakra of Vishnu and this is the shankha of Vishnu. Pallava period Dwarapalakas in most cases are a dead giveaway as to which deity would have been inside. But I leave that for later, for those who are going to be dealing with art. So this is how the lion base looks. Very clearly, clearly sculpted. And today, called the Varaha Cave Temple, there is going to be another Varaha that we'll be seeing. That will be the Adi Varaha. This is the Varaha Cave Temple. You see here, amazing, amazing image of Varaha. With his face turns towards his right, and this is Bhudevi. And it is unfortunately a much damaged panel, but nevertheless, just look at how Bhudevi has turned her feet towards Varaha. She was there at the bottom of the ocean and he had lifted her. Suddenly a savior comes, takes her away from the clutches of Hiranyaksha. We must understand how she would have felt. Suddenly some person coming up and bashfully turned inside. And the absolute grand nature of Varaha and what he is doing with Surya on this side, and obviously this must be Chandra also with Brahma over here. The greatness of the Pallava sculptor clearly comes through in this image when you see this Rishi with his back turned and his long hair over here. Difficult to sculpt a person frontally. To do it from the back, you must be a master sculptor banging directly on the rock. I always say this, and I know I'm repeating myself, but if this man or the group of men here had made a mistake, that mistake would have been there for us, for me to point out today to you. But there was no mistake done. And this in 3/4, he's turned around here, turned around over here. Who was this? Maybe a musician, Rishi, with something in his hand. Everything is left open. My guess is as good as, absolutely as good as yours. So this is what, this is something that I always like looking at. Not only have the feet been exquisitely carved, but look, the fingers are not all aligned properly. There's one finger going in and there's one finger coming out. This man had noticed something and then he has translated it into hard rock. Who was he? Wish we could know his name. And the famous Prayoga Chakra of the Pallava period, where the flat face of the discus is not shown to us, but the edge. Unfortunately, it is damaged, but more about Prayoga Chakra. And the way Vishnu is holding it, very delicately between the thumb and the index finger. Just that light touch. That's the Pallava touch. We quickly run along to Badami. I'm taking you quickly to Karnataka, to Bagalgod district, where the Chalukyas were ruling. The Chalukyas being the contemporaries of the Pallavas, and at the same time, the contemporary of Harshavardhana of Kannauj, the famous Harshavardhana. In history textbooks, myopic in their view are these people who create the syllabus and the people who write the text. Therefore, at the Vindhyas, everything stops. And we hear of Harshavardhana. We've all been fed on Harshavardhana, but we don't know that Chalukya Pulakeshin, one of the greatest rulers of India, was a contemporary of Harshavardhana. Just look at your textbooks, do a Google search. His date will be the same as Harsha. And then further south here, you have Narasimha Varman and Mahendra Varman at the same time. Further south, you have the Pandyas. In Bengal, something happened. Gujarat, something happened. But only central India will be focused on. And that's what we've been fed on. So let's try to do things a little different now. So we go to Badami when the Chalukyas were ruling. And we quickly go to Cave 2 over here just to see another Varaha. An amazingly beautiful Bhu Varaha, just as we see in Mamallapuram. Only thing, again, this is a very controversial issue and I don't want to step on any toes, but I will be doing it fully throughout this talk, I think. But it's just that this was slightly earlier than the Pallavas, and we are not talking about invasions that happened. Those also happened, but crisscross cultural links have always been there in India, from things going from one place to the other. So maybe the Pallavas learnt from the Chalukyas, and sometimes the Chalukyas also learnt from the Pallavas. Almost ditto. It's absolutely beautiful. You also see the Prayoga Chakra here. Now, it looks as though the face is pointing towards us. But then look at the direction in which Varaha faces. He is facing like that. So the chakra is facing his direction and it is a Prayoga Chakra. We quickly go to Cave 3 in Badami. passing through all this. And for those who have not been to Badami, this is the view you will get as you climb from cave 1 to cave 2 to 3 and then to 4. Cave 3 is possibly the most beautiful cave, and this is how it looks. As soon as you go in and you turn to your left, you see this very amazing Vishnu. Again, notice his Prayoga Chakra. And then right on this side, you have a Varaha. Now, let's understand that this stone was sandstone. I am not for a moment saying that sandstone is very easy to carve on. It's also a difficult stone because it's flaky. But then granite is tough. And I would like you to notice the lines of the sandstone rock. That's natural. It seemed to me that these lines are not very clearly seen on this rock. And this is my theory. It's that the sculptors of Badami chose this rock for Varaha. Doesn't it seem to you as though he's rising from the waters? All this being the water of the ocean, and then yes, he's gently coming up out of it. So these are the kind of sculptors we had around that time. So again, look at the way he is hooked that chakra between the index finger and the thumb. Same thing. And this is the inscription that gives you the date of cave 3. This is a 6th century inscription. Again, details are not necessary right now. We are coming back to the Varaha cave in Mamallapuram. Very clearly, this is a Gajalakshmi. Any one of you here, even the children in the audience, can identify this as Gajalakshmi. And generally, whenever we see Gajalakshmi, we see her in Padmasana, that yogic posture where you have... this is also Padmasana, because she's not in that posture we know as Padmasana today, but she's seated on a lotus. Asana is seated on the Padma, so this is also Padmasana, all right? And then with the Padmahasta, two lotuses in her hands, only thing you don't see the two lotuses there, but they're virtually there, Tamil Virtual Academy, so this is virtually there. And then the two elephants, so this is Gajalakshmi, and the Gaja, the two elephants we see today, even on our gold coins and these stickers that we have above our entrance doorways, are both perfectly poised above her head and pouring the Abhisheka Jala. But here, as you see, this elephant in profile pouring water. Please note the pot is directly on top of her head. It's perfectly aligned for the water to go through. And then this elephant is taking, and he is seen almost frontally. So, this is what we call an animated sculpture. We talk of animation these days. What is this if not animated? So, this elephant will do that Abhishekam and bring his trunk down and take this pot of water, by which time this elephant would have taken this pot of water and done the Abhisheka. So, ipdi varum, mari mari, it'll come. And these are her maids that are waiting over here. Look at that fold of the ear of that elephant, and this is how you will see an elephant in profile. Even if we take a photograph, I don't think it will come out. Seems to me this elephant is actually laughing, he's smiling, he's so happy at doing this Abhisheka. Post Pallava, what happens is, not for a moment am I taking away anything from the art of later periods. I think it is very wrong to compare and contrast. But then what happens is that a certain stylization sets in. We are going to Ellora, 8th century Rashtrakuta. And again, this is Lakshmi. Here, clearly seated in Padmasana. Two elephants on this side and two more here doing Abhisheka with two pots of water directly above her head. From this time onwards, and a little earlier itself, I'm only showing you 8th century Ellora, a certain convention sets in. This is how it should be. The freedom of expression that the Pallava sculptors had is somewhat curbed. I don't know who curbed it, or maybe the artists themselves decided that this is how it should be. And then we go to Chola, we go to Gangaikonda Cholapuram, just see how it is. It's all very, very perfect. This is an amazing Lakshmi. Each has something new to offer. For example, in Ellora, you see this complete and beautiful pond of lotuses, as though Lakshmi is seated right in the center. Something new comes up, but that little exotic flavor of the Pallavas has gone somewhat. That's there. And then we come to Durga. Here, we are back in the Varaha cave temple. Durga, not as Mahishasuramardini, not as Simhavahini, but she's just standing over there in Katihasta. And you see the Shivaganas around her. And then many people have done research on this, these kind of sculptures of men offering their heads to Durga. For those of you who have not seen this sculpture before or have not noticed this man, he is holding his hair with the top of his, with his hand and cutting off his head to offer at the feet of Durga, and this man very clearly is cutting off his hand. The same thing you will see in what is called the Draupadi Ratha also. The lion, all right, we understand, it is very much part of Durga's entourage, but why the antelope? Harini Durga, Harini is a deer also, and it is known that Durga image should have the deer as well, and you have the chatra, the umbrella, to show her royalty. We have Durga images in other places. This is the same one. I'm going now to the fourth panel of Trivikrama in the same Varaha cave, and very quickly running out of time as I can see. Trivikrama, Ulahalanda Perumal, standing on what foot, with the second foot going right up there. You see his foot there. As I have said before, and as I am repeating, and I will repeat in future, I have no idea who this artist was, but when I try to copy this onto a piece of paper using a pencil, I reach for the eraser first. I've tried it, because these four hands come in front of this leg, and you're seeing this leg only in parts. You see the thigh, a little bit here, and then the ankle, and then the foot. So, did he sculpt the hands first, or did he sculpt those pieces of the leg first? And the proportion is simply perfect. And here, again, there are four hands. In this hand, this lowermost one, he holds a sword, passing over this hand, over that hand, and underneath this hand. Great work, absolutely great work. And the person who receives the tip of his toe here is Brahma. You've heard the famous Anamacharya Kirtana, Brahma Gatikina Padamo. That is, Brahma was there in Satyaloka, and suddenly the Bhagavata Purana, I wish I could quote it here, but I really don't have much time. The Bhagavata Purana says, Brahma was sitting there, and suddenly he sees the lustre of the nails of Vishnu coming in front of him. And he, unbelievably, he just doesn't know what to do. So he has his kamandalam with water, and he washes the foot of the visitor who has come to his abode in Satyaloka. And that water coming from the foot of Vishnu goes down as Ganga. And that's why Ganga is also called Vishnupadi, because she comes from the padam of Vishnu. Extensive quotations there are in the Bhagavata Purana. It's absolutely delightful. The nails come, and then the foot comes, and then the leg comes into Satyaloka, and Brahma is totally astonished. We will also understand that this Pallava sculptor clearly wanted us to understand that Brahma's abode in Satyaloka is much above the Surya and the Chandra that we see high above our heads. So therefore, he sculpts one Surya here and one Chandra here, and then the foot goes right above. And this person here, nobody notices. We think of him as a monkey. We don't even know who this is. This is Jambavan, one of the four Chiranjeevis of the Ramayanam, three Chiranjeevis other than Vibhishana and Hanuman. And this is Jambavan beating a drum called the Beri. Beri, Mridangavadyamu, these are all ancient musical instruments. And in the Valmiki Ramayanam, Jambavan tells his monkey friends, just before they are going to cross the ocean in search of Sita, that I was there when Vishnu was Trivikrama, and when he rose in height, I went around his head beating the Beri. That is his message to his monkey friends. So he was there before the Ramavatara, our Jambavan, and he was there after the Ramavatara also, and that is him. So these sculptors had not only knew the art of carving, they also knew these very ancient itihasas and puranas. They had internalized it, otherwise they could not have produced it here. There is much more. This is supposed to be Trishanku. Again, controversial. Trishanku is that person whose heaven, his swarga, was neither in heaven nor on earth. It was in between, which is why when we are always confused, we say Trishanku swarga, we don't know where we are. Therefore, to show the space between heaven and earth, to fill it up, they have showed Trishanku over here. That's there, possibly, yes. And that is Brahma's asana, the Padma Peetam. That's there on the ceiling of this temple all these lovely designs, if we care to notice when we go there, we should never be in a hurry to leave Mamallapuram. Lovely designs. We go to the Mahishasura Mardini cave temple. Again, I'm not at all going to say whose period this is. Was it Rajasimha? Was it Parameshwara Varman, etc.? This photograph clearly shows this cave temple cut in and right above a structural stone temple. Completely different century. This is 100% of the 8th century of the time of Rajasimha, and this two different types of architecture where you cut in and create a cave temple, and then finally at a much later stage you put stone upon stone and build a temple. Sadly, I read in a newspaper many years ago that somebody had written, I'm not giving the names nor the name of the newspaper, that this is the only secular monument in Mamallapuram. They said secular because it was used as a lighthouse, you see. But then far before it was used as a lighthouse, it was a temple for Shiva. And this is the kind of knowledge we have these days. It's very sad. And this was how this whole place looked once upon a long time back. You notice that this pillar is clearly missing. Many such pillars are missing, were missing in Mamallapuram. And the ASI has filled it up now. See, this huge gap is there. This is how it is. This is why you see that this pillar is distinctly different from the two corner ones. This is also different. You can see that it was broken here. This palaha also would have found a place here and in this pillar as well. So just going through these, if you find it different, now you know why. We go to again an absolutely animated panel of Mahishasura Mardini, pop class act by the Pallava sculptors. We'll hasten through this because I know other speakers are going to be stressing on this. You have a multi-armed Durga here holding various weapons, the bow, an arrow, a bell and various other things. We notice a royal umbrella over her head. She's riding on a lion. Notice very carefully, you can see her other foot hanging on this side. It's as though we were riding on a horse, astride a horse, and numerous Shiva Ganas, the Bhuta Ganas helping her out, and Mahishasura just about to topple. When you go there, please crouch at the foot of Mahishasura and then look at him from that angle. He's grimacing. He's not able to hold his balance, just like when we are going to fall off. There's the same expression. And this is Durga. Chin up. Absolutely in control. This one arrow is going to go and then Mahishasura will be gone. So this is an old photograph. Look at it from every angle possible, and you can see the Pallava sculptors have studied the anatomy of the male and the female form, and it's absolutely perfect. Just for a moment, we'll cross over to Maharashtra, to Ellora, to the time of the Rashtrakutas, and here also you see very many Mahishasura Mardinis. You see one here and you see one here. I have absolutely no doubt that this sculptor or this group of sculptors at Ellora had seen the Mahishasura Mardini panel in Mamallapuram. I don't doubt it at all. Here again, the face of the buffalo is not there, but the horns are there. Look at the way the lion is jumping forward, almost the same as that. The way she is sitting may be slightly different. Her foot is not on the other side, but sitting as though balancing on the lion. And all these, her Shivaganas apparently are not there, but look below, they're all here. The ones that we saw around her in Mamallapuram. And these are all the forces, the people who have come with Mahishasura. They're almost all gone. Notice here, again, the royal umbrella is there and the two chamaras also. Again, multi-armed, holding almost the same weapons. You see, the bow is here. Again, the arrow is not shown. Only the attitude of letting go of that arrow, that next minute it's going to be gone. It's not the same, but it's very similar. And that being 7th century or perhaps 8th, and this also definitely later, maybe they took their cue from Mamallapuram. And we are coming back to the Mahishasura Mardini cave temples. Cave temple. Everything is perfect. Look at that foot, the paw of the lion and the other foot on the other side. Can't get more natural than this. Her weapons, a gada over here. This is the ghanta, the bell. The Prayoga Chakra, the arrow which we is seen and yet not seen, the bow holding hand, and various other weapons as well. The conch is very clearly seen over here. and with this lady, absolutely fit lady, knocking off another Rakshasa, and all the Shivaganas holding various weapons, and that's Mahishasura almost completely gone. I'll just pass through these slides. Can you see this Chambara over here? The same thing we saw in Ellora also. Later, these chinnams of the Shankha and Chakra were engraved. On opposite side, this is a complete takeoff from the Devi Bhagavatam. You have Vishnu absolutely relaxed, absolutely contained. This is in Yoga Nidra, and his exhalation are supposed to send Madhu and Kaitabha, these two Rakshasas, fleeing. They just came to harm him and they couldn't stand at all. Now, one is Madhu and one is Kaitabha, which is why Vishnu is called Madhusudanaha, one who is the destroyer of Madhu. And we name a child Madhusudan and we end up calling him Madhu. We are calling him after a Rakshasa's name, basically. So, and then here, there are these figures which we shouldn't forget, identified differently by different scholars. This is Bhudevi, perhaps. And then these are the Ayudha Purushas, the personifications of the weapons of Vishnu, the Shankha, Chakra, Gada, and the sword called the Nandaka. The Shankha is called the Panchajanya, the Chakra is called Sudarshana, the sword is called the Nandaka, and the Gada is called Kaumodaki. So whichever is which, this lady here represents Kaumodaki Gada. Because in Sanskritam, Gada is feminine gender. You have masculine, feminine, and neuter. Gada, feminine. So it has to be represented as a lady. This possibly is the Panchajanya, the conch, given the rotund size, the shape. And this perhaps is Sudarshana, and this could be Nandaka. Your guess is as good as mine. And Everett, sorry. Many books by many authors, and these are the different things. Look at the depth that's given over here, and look at that expression of Vishnu. You saw Durga, all confidence personified, raring to go at Mahishasura. He does it without an expression on his face. Same thing is here. These are the Ayudha Purushas that you see. Possibly Sudarshana. You can see movement over here. Sudarshana Chakra is always moving. And this possibly the Nandaka and Bhudevi, perhaps. Taking you just for a moment for a comparative study to Dhyogar, Gupta period temple. This is called the Dashavatara temple, though there are no sculptures of Dashavatara. Here you see a reclining Vishnu. This is much, much before the Mahishasuramardini cave temple. And here again is Vishnu reclining. And these again are supposed to be the Ayudha Purushas. Notice the lady. This is Kaumodaki Gada, this perhaps is Sudarshana, this is perhaps the Sharga, the bow of Vishnu, given the shape of his arm, and this could be the Nandaka, the sword. So it's known in India to do that. Coming back to the Mahishasuramardini cave temple, the central figure here is not Mahishasuramardini, but this, the Somaskanda form, and here you see Sir Uma Skanda, that leads us to Soma Skanda, that is the Sanskrit compound word. Shiva with Parvati with the baby here. I'm afraid it's not a very good photograph. And Shiva and Parvati resting their foot on Nandi and flanked by Brahma and Vishnu on either side. Michael Lockwood's, Professor Michael Lockwood's book gives the 24 different Somaskanda Murtis are there, and they are not all similar. They are different from time to time to time. You see, Rajasimha Somaskanda is different from the pre-Rajasimha Somaskanda. There are small variations given the hastas of Shiva and the way Parvati is seated. Small changes are there. But anyway, this is the central figure as we see it over here. There was no linga here, we assume, and that people wanted to plant one at a later date. Controversial subject into which I shall not enter, but just throwing light here and there. The Panchapandava Mantapa, which is next to the Arjuna's penance. What they've tried to do here is something amazing, and which they did to full measure in Ellora later, that they tried to put a Pradakshina passage through. It's incomplete, and this pillar is also broken at a later date. A main Garbhagriha, incomplete, and then you have to go here and then and go here. They have made a passage, but then it doesn't link at the back. Something stopped at some point of time. So this is what they were trying to do. Stupendous effort to trying to tunnel through hard granite, leaving the Garbhagriha in the center. You should make a hole on this side and a hole on that side and connect it to the back. The whole thing should not cave in. The Garbhagriha walls should not break. What an effort, but unfortunately not done. These are the parts of Mamallapuram that we generally go to when we go through the back. This, again, noticing the lady door guardians, the Dwara Palikas, we know that this should have been for Durga. Or perhaps Lakshmi, most likely Durga. These are all unfinished cave temples. Look at the stance of this Dwarapalika. Just look at her. She's in Tribhanga. The three bends in the body, like you would see an Odissi dancer do. What grace. And look at her. Each is different. This is the rear side of Mamallapuram. You have to go through the Trimurti cave and then go to the back. And this is how it looks. I'm going to run through this a bit fast. Unfinished. All of them. You can see the work that they were trying to do. What caused them to stop? What war happened? A border which itself is in need of some protection, I would feel. And this is a five-cell temple, again unfinished, for five different deities. Your guess here would be as good as mine, with very, very amazing pillars. In here, again, the Shankha and Chakra etched at a later date. We go through this butterball, through these crevices in the rock, to go to the Trimurti cave temple, where you can see the central portion jutting out is for Shiva. That's the main god here. And on this side, you have Vishnu. And the other side, generally Trimurti would mean Brahma. But here you have Subramanya as Brahma Shasta, a linga that has been planted at a later time. So this is the Vishnu Garbhagriha, chiseled right into the rock. Please keep an eye on these Dwarapalakas. If you go to Mamallapuram, I would like to suggest, do a trip just to see the Dwarapalakas and the Dwarapalikas. It's worth that visit. Each is different. No two are similar. Just imagine. Not done in one period of time. It's taken a long time. He almost in profile, and this a frontal view. A care has been taken for each and every element. And that's Vishnu over here. These two are devotees with Vismaya Hasta. You see something astonishing and then your hand goes up like that. They do that in dance as well. This Shiva Sanctum, again, look at the Dwarapalakas. Completely, completely different. That's Shiva over here, which was the object of worship, which was the only object of worship at one point of time. And then finally, you have Subramanya over here, not Brahma, as we would think. Look at this Durga. The one that we saw earlier was just Durga standing. Here she's standing on Mahishasura. Let us look at this lovely Torana that's on top. These pictures are nothing at all. You just have to stand before it and keep looking at it. This is Durga. How often has Durga been repeated in Mamallapuram? How often has the Anantashayi Vishnu, there are three, and plus one that is half done also. The four Anantashayi Vishnus are there. And this is this amazing round thing just before the Trimurti cave temple. How they did it and how we keep it is another issue altogether. This is another one of the lovely, very lovely panels, which is near the Trimurti cave. And this is an elephant. Male elephant. See that tusker. We see only that Arjuna, the penance panel, but there's another one, the lovely little one, female elephant and two baby elephants playing, unfortunately vandalized at some point of time. Look at it from any angle, how they have studied the anatomy of animals, of human beings, the male form, the female form, and all. This is not there now, but at a time when I took it, all this is dated. The Pallavas didn't date it. Even the folds near the mouth of the elephant, just look at all this. I'm sorry. I'm very sorry. All this is very clearly there. And the baby, as baby elephants will rock and roll, that's there in literature. They've studied literature, these Pallava artisans, there's no doubt. Monkeys as monkeys would be, and peacocks as peacocks are. All that. and all the graffiti. Ramanuja Mantapam, the name being a complete misnomer, it has nothing to do with Ramanuja Acharya at all. In fact, Rama Anuja is Lakshmanan. That's nothing to do with Lakshmana either. And this is how it looks at some point of time. Big time vandalism having happened. Image of Somaskanda Murthy was completely chiseled off. These are the places that people generally visiting Mamallapuram on a day's visit or a couple of hours visit do not go to. One side was Durga, that is also chiseled off. Another side was another figure. We really can't identify it properly. In all likelihood, it was Lakshmi. That has also been chiseled off. And all that remains here are the lion pillars for us to see. And this is how the lion, this is what was and now isn't. And then the Shankar Chakra having come up there. All these were to be some things, but it just didn't happen. Now steps leading to virtually nowhere. And here we get a fantastic idea of how they went about doing their cave temples. In Mamallapuram, you have every stage of architecture. You have the cave temple, you have the five ratas. We'll come to that very quickly. And then you also have the structural temple, but this is how they were going to go about it. Can you see? They have outlines of the pillars are there. They were going to dig all this out. Coming to the Adivaraha cave temple, which is in active, very active worship even now. Let me just read this out for you. But before I forget one thing, I want to tell you that we don't know the names of these architects and sculptors, not one, by way of inscriptions. But we have one name by way of literature. You see, the Pallava kings were not only patrons of architecture and sculpture, they were patrons of men of letters. They were great patrons of scholars. And the two names that come to us are Bharavi and Dandin. Dandin, Bharavi, who wrote the Kirat Arjuniyam, the fight between Arjuna and Shiva, which you see beautifully portrayed in the form of a sculpture in the Kailasanatha temple in Kanchipuram. And Dandin, who wrote very important works which students of Sanskrit study even today, like the Dashakumara Charitam, the Kavya Darsha, and the Avanti Sundari Katha. The Avanti Sundari Katha is a story of a very beautiful girl called Avanti. But here, Dandin mentions a famous architect called Lalita Laya, who was an expert in building, I'm reading here, 96 kinds of temples, Shanvati Prasad Vidhi Visharadaha, 6 kinds of mechanical devices, Shadvidhanam Yantranam, and had all the 36 qualifications prescribed for an architect, Shatrimshat Acharya Gunair Alankritaha. He once requested the then king, who was in all likelihood Rajasimha Pallava, and also Dandin, to inspect an image of Vishnu at Mamallapuram. His broken arm he had rectified. When the king and Dandin saw the image, they were unable to find out where the arm of the statue had been repaired. So well had Lalita Laya done his work. Dandin mentions that Lalita Laya's skills surpassed even that of the Greeks who had arrived at the court of the king of Kanchi. Here, very clear that Lalita Laya, two things are very clear. The serious aspect is that Lalita Laya was an excellent architect who could mend even the arm of a stone image of Vishnu without knowing where the mending work has happened. Second thing, that then, as of now, we are always comparing Indians to the West. So that also, I was taken aback, as good as the Greeks, why? We had all of this here in India. Why compare him with a Greek? I don't know. Anyway, coming to the Adivaraha cave temple, it was of the time of Parameshwara Varman. And I'll just give you the old, the original name by which I feel we should call it even now. It's the Parameshwara, I'll get it in a second. This is how the image actually looks in active worship even today. This is a stucco image which is painted. This is the Utsava Murthy that we have. Quickly going to Thiruvidandai, which we have to cross to go to Mamallapuram, this is how the Adivaraha here looks. And this is the Utsava Murthy of Nitya Kalyana Perumal. So the Pallavas were all about the Varaha. So in the Adivaraha cave, you have sculptures very, very similar to the Varaha cave that I first showed you. Here you have Durga, but here she is Mahishasuramardini and she is in Tribhanga, unlike the straight Samabhanga Durga which we saw. and again flanked by two devotees over here. Here we see Gajalakshmi almost ditto what we saw in the Varaha cave temple, almost. And again, animated panel. We have Gangadhara here. How come a Gangadhara in a Vishnu temple? In those days, there weren't that many differences. And here you have Brahma. This is Brahma. You can see three of his four faces. But what we should pay attention to each of these sculptures. What we have Brahma doing here is one hand resting on his hip. This is Katihasta, the right hand. The left hand is in Abhaya. Don't fear. How do you bless a person with your right hand? Why is he doing it with his left? Very strange. I don't know of another sculpture in India where a god would be seeing blessing devotees with his left hand. And if I have got this wrong, I don't know. I would like a clarification, but no one I have asked till now has ever given me anything. It's very intriguing. It's very complex. It's the riddle that is in the sands. And again, here you have Harihara, Vishnu and Shiva over here. This is Vishnu himself with the Prayoga Chakra. And this is a portrait sculpture. There's nothing Mamallapuram doesn't have. It has everything. You can compare it with the Mahabharata. They say everything is there in the Mahabharata. You have everything in Mamallapuram, including portrait sculptures, a king with his two queens, and the inscription says Mahendra Varman in different words. But I really am running out of time, so I'm rushing. Here it's Simha Varman over here. Now this is where the question lies. Is this Narasimha Varman or is it Simha Varman? And if this is Mahendra Varman, which Mahendra Varman? We have two Mahendra Varmans. If we ascribe this cave to Narasimha Varman the first Mamalla, then this is Mahendra Varman, his father, and that is, this one is Simha Vishnu, his grandfather. If we are ascribing this cave temple to Parameshwara Varman, which would be the right choice, then this would be Mahendra Varman the second, his father, and this would be Narasimha Varman Mamalla, his grandfather. Again, there is one big question mark hanging in the air. Even this has not been conclusively proved. Wherever you go, you are left in doubt. Like when we come to these five monoliths, which we mistakenly call the Panchapandava Rathas, a horrible term that is. And they are not Rathas and nothing to do with the Panchapandavas. Most annoying. And these are old photographs of how this place was. Again, questions. Okay, top to bottom, this has been cut. We all know it's a monolith, fine. What happened to the stupi? What happened to the finial? We all know that they started work on top and came straight down, all right. So did they start work with the kalasha on top and then did they come straight down? Or there's a kalasha over here which seems to be not of the same time as this. Had they made it earlier, another one, and were they going to fit it in on top? If they were going to fit it in on top, then it would not have been a monolith. What are we thinking of here? We don't understand. And Professor Michael Lockwood clearly says that in the reign of Narasimha Varman, they were crisscross. They were always fighting, the Chalukyas and the Pallavas, up and down and up and down and up and down. We know that Pulakeshin came almost up to the doorstep of Mahendra Varman's fort in the 7th century. And Mahendra Varman saved himself. And then Narasimha Varman went in revenge and conquered the Chalukya land, and he raised Vatapi, the capital, today's Badami, to the ground. And again, Pulakeshin came in revenge. Then his son Vikramaditya came in revenge. So according to Michael Lockwood, these five monoliths, each was started with the stupi down, the kalasha down. And that during that war, Vikramaditya's army cut off all the finials, and therefore they were damaged, and therefore work stopped. But then this has been opposed by very many scholars also. I'm just giving you this side and that side. Then we come later to the Ganesha Ratha, we'll come to that, where stupi down, it is perfect. But then that seems to have been done after this invasion came and went, and therefore that it is perfect. Well, we'll see. So to begin with, was there one on top? And because it got knocked down, this is not in worship today. This is for Durga, and this is there today. Many, many, many questions cross our minds. We'll not know what the exact thing is, but this followed a certain pattern. Here again you will notice the wood tradition. These were supposed to imitate wooden rafters to hold up a thatched roof, and this was a model of something, and perhaps a metal design to hold the thatched roof in place. Maybe, probably, we don't know. And then the Dwarapalikas are very beautifully done, and Durga inside, not Mahishasuramardini, no Simha here, and people cutting off various parts of their body to offer to her. And the three sides of the Durga temple have images of Durga over here. The whole platform being held up with the lions and elephants, and this lion, this also not completed, because if it had been completed, all the matrix here would have been removed and he would have been standing on four legs. That's there. And then we quickly go to the next one. You all know of all of this, but this is a survey that I have to do, so I'm doing it. Meant for Shiva. There's a Nandi at the back to prove it to you, and this is how it looked once upon a long time back. The Arjuna Ratha is possibly the most beautiful sculptures wise. Here you see Vishnu, this is Garuda over here. All this is completely amazing work. Is this Indra on an elephant, or is this Harihara Putra, Ayyappan on an elephant? Different theories that are floating around, I'm offering all of them to you. This is the back wall. On one side you have Vishnu on Garuda. On the other side here you have Shiva on the Nandi. So some people have thought this is Hari and Hara on either side, and this is Harihara Putra, or maybe this is Indra. Very clearly how Shiva leans on the Nandi here is absolutely amazing. So very graceful for 1400 years. And this as such, this is the Ananta Shayana, Vishnu for him, and that's why it's a broad thing. Can we not see the Kalashas having been cut off perhaps, and maybe they started work top down, maybe, could be, is that what it was? Many other parts are damaged at the top. Maybe they were trying to complete work when this war broke out and it didn't quite happen. It seems to be from this photo that there were finials on top, perhaps. It's a view that we certainly have to bear in mind. Here also there were some. Can you see all this? Every top bit has been knocked off, and so it seems. And then we clearly see that work started at the top and came towards the bottom. And one improvement from the other Rathas here is that they were trying to make a Pradakshina passage. Clearly going through all this, the final, the Dharmaraja Ratha for Shiva in three stories, later to be copied in the Vaikuntha Perumal temple in Kanchipuram, in the Uttaramerur temple, and down south in the Pandyan country as well. These Ashtanga Vimanas became extremely common, and many parts here also have these stupis, and those were also knocked down. And this from a later date to be hoisted on top. The work was not done in any one century or by any one king. It has continued for a long time. Apparently, even after the destruction of the stupis happened, work continued on these five monuments, but never ever to be completed, and we are the poorer for it. So very many parts of this Shiva temple. The first two sannadhis have been completed, and later they haven't. And here you find the different titles of a king, whether it's Narasimha Varman the first or whether it's Narasimha Varman the second, we will not know. Let me just very quickly read out these titles. It's very interesting. Flows beautifully in Sanskrit. Atimanaha, Atyantakamaha, Anekopayaha, Anupamaha, Apratihata, Shasanaha, Ameya Mayaha, Kama Lalitaha, Trilokyavardhanaha, Nayana Manoharaha, Nayanankuraha, Srinarsumaha, Niruttaha, Parabharaha, Prithvisaraha, Bhuvanabhajanaha, Madhanabhiramaha, the charming god of love he was, Mahamallaha, Ranajayaha, Lalitaha, Vamaha, Vidihi, Vibhra, श्रीनिधि श्रीभर श्रीमेघ सकल कल्याण सत्यपराक्रम सर्वथो भद्र स्थिर भक्ति. These many titles have been carved on this monument, various parts of this monument. I mean, the people who thought of these names, it couldn't have been the king himself. What great scholars! Each word is of poetic essence. It would I'm sure Dr. Shankaranarayanan is going to do it. Amazing Sanskritam, amazing poetry in each of these compound words, telling you about who the king was. Shri Megha, auspicious cloud, that's all. How auspicious a cloud can be, we will know from the Megha Sandesha of Kalidasa. These people would have studied the Megha Sandesha of Kalidasa before calling the king Shri Megha. There's absolutely no doubt about it. To tell you, this is my all-time favorite sculpture in Mamallapuram. All-time favorite, there cannot be something more beautiful, more accurate than this. Starting from cheek down, when you go there, please notice, this photo is nothing at all. Starting from that smile, it's half-half. Ardhanari, definitely. And then all of you know this, there are Shivas, this is Subramanya, and the titles on top. This is Shiva again, and finally you have our king, whether it is Mahamalla, whether it is Narasimhavarman the first, whether it is Rajasimha or Narasimhavarman the second, we leave that. The question marks hang still. How perfectly etched this is. Can I just take another 5 to 10 minutes, please? All right. All very many different parts of this. You have a Ganesha over here, right plonked there in front of the Dharmaraja Ratha. He wasn't...
You can take up 10 minutes extra. We have time for questions also. So no problem.
Okay, thanks. So then it is known that there was no Ganesha worship prior to the 7th century in the Pallava country. It was there down south in the Pandya country. It was there up north in the Chalukya country. And that it was Vatapi Kondan, that is Narasimhavarman, who brought that Ganesha from Vatapi by his army general Paranjyoti, who later became Sirutonda Nayanar. All that is very clear. I'm just thinking, this huge piece of rock, it sloped from south to north. How they would just slice it like this and make 4 different monuments out of it top down. I mean, what a wonder, what an aschirium we have here in Mamallapuram. You can just keep gazing at it. And the 5th of the monuments, Nakula Sahadevaratha, that is over here. Again, so minuscule, so small, but so profound. And this is how it looks. Clearly of the Gajaprishta architecture with the rounded back. So nicely done. Absolutely fantastic and almost complete except for the deity inside. Was it for Indra? Because Indra rode on the elephant. Was it for Subramanya? Because Subramanya also rode on the elephant. There is a small sculpture of a 6-sided small shrine and on the front side of this temple. So some scholars are thinking 6-sided. So maybe this was for Shanmukha. And really, any guess is perfect over here. We have no conclusive answers. But then all they were trying to tell you is that this was a Gaja Prishta. Prishta back Gaja elephant shaped monument. And without telling us in so many words, they are placing a nice small elephant over here. They chose, look at the choice, 2 small boulders sitting next to each other. One a Gaja Prishta temple and then a Gaja with its Prishta showing towards us. Perfect, absolutely perfect. Even if we didn't know all of this, this is a gem of a sculpture. Now tell me, am I seeing things, am I hallucinating, or is there a band around here? And if there is a band here, they are definitely showing you a tamed elephant that was used by the elephant, by a king. Is this being done on purpose? Surely this line had to be done on purpose. But then when it comes to Mamallapuram, everybody's imagination runs riot. I don't know. See, you can see it on this side also. Very clearly there. Why was it there? It was there intentionally. I don't know. And the tusks are also not done. So perhaps they wanted to pull out the tusks of some dead war elephant and insert it there. Then it would look like a very, very nice live elephant in twilight in the morning and in the evening. Or maybe they did insert tusks there and somebody pulled it out. Don't know. Absolutely. But that it's not completed because this place again has not been hewn out and you don't see the nails of the elephant either. So this is how this place looked once upon a long time back and how it looks now. How we keep a World Heritage Site here in Tamil Nadu. The Ganesha Ratha, so called today, it looks like this. Slightly damaged, but the Kalashas are there on top. What you clearly notice here is a Trishula. showing it to be a temple for Shiva, as also an inscription that is over there. I wanted to read out so much, but then I'm very clearly running out of time. I have that inscription here. See, old photographs, Trishula showing very clearly. There would have been one on this side, and then it got unfortunately damaged. Quickly taking you to Orissa, to the Jagannath temple, Puri. Note that in the temples in the north, you have the symbols showing which deity it is right on top. So this is Jagannath temple, you have the Sudarshana Chakra up there. There it is. And then you go to the Mukteshwara temple in Bhuvaneshwar, Shiva temple, you have the Trishula sitting up there. That tradition obviously was there in Tamil Nadu, because you see the Trishula up there on top of the Ganesha Ratha. Perhaps each of the other Rathas that we found destroyed or unfinished also were meant to have these symbols on top. So we're coming back here. This is the Ganesha Ratha sitting right there, long time ago. I think this photograph tells us of how Mamallapuram once was. And there are inscriptions on the walls of the Ganesha Ratha in Sanskritam, in the Pallava Grantha, extolling the greatness of Shiva. This is Parameshwara Varman's product. And the last verse is very, very nice. It's a curse. It's an imprecatory verse that is also found in few of the other monuments in Mamallapuram, like the Ramanuja Mantapa that we saw. It says, Diktesham, Diktesham, Punarbi, Dik, 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 Digastu, Diktesham. That is, cursed be those, six times cursed be those in whose hearts Rudra does not dwell, in whose hearts Shiva does not dwell. So that was Parameshwar Varman's statement that he left in no less than four places. Going to the outskirts of Mamallapuram, which sometimes looks like this and very, very beautiful, we go to these completely unfinished monoliths. These two are called the Pidari Rathas, just because there is a Pidari temple situated close by for Kali, Durga, that's all. But you can see how they started at the top. Now I'm wondering, were these two stupis also broken, and is that why this is also incomplete? We don't know. So that is the Pallavi of this whole song. We don't know, we don't know, we keep coming back to that. And this is in its very, very unfinished state. We know how they went about it, but I think we would have been far better off had all these been... this is the Valangyan Kuttai Ratha. That's how we have to do it. This is a fisherman's pond, and that name has been given to this. This also unfinished, needless to say, like most of the monuments. I won't, I'll just quickly go through the other slides. I won't even touch upon the penance panels. I'm sorry. Just give me a minute. I won't touch upon the penance panels because Dr. Swaminathan is going to be doing it in great detail. But we'll quickly go to the Sthalashayana Perumal Temple, which again is monumental. I'll just mention this Gopuram over here, Vijayanagara period. Unfortunately, again, not completed. Was there a jinx on Mamallapuram that even people who came 8 decades later could not complete anything that they started over here? What we find very beautifully is Ganga and Yamuna, two sets of sculptures of Ganga and Yamuna, and we pass through them and we go inside over here. I'll just show you, and very, very rare, we don't see it often, just above the head, you see the Dashavatara. You can see the Matsya, Kurma, Varaha, Narasimha, Vamana, 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 Rama, 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 Kalki. I have not seen it anywhere else till now. We go to the Sthalashayana Perumal Temple. It's one of the 108 Divya Desham, sung about by Arvars. Naturally, Bhudat Arvar, who was born in Mamallapuram, and also Thirumangai Arvar. The Perumal inside is lying down, but he is not lying down on Adisesha. He is Thalashayana, Thalashayana. He is absolutely on the floor. This temple was completely rebuilt in later times. There is again a big question mark hanging on this. Is this the original Divya Desham, or is the show temple, which has Shiva sanctums on either side and there's a Vishnu right in the center, is that the original Divya Desham? Also another question mark hanging on this Lalita Laya repair repairing an arm of Vishnu, was it that one that Lalitalaya repaired, that arm of that Vishnu that's lying on the seashore? And incidentally, now that Vishnu on the seashore is clearly sandwiched between two Shiva sanctums, one facing east and one facing west. The one on the east is the bigger temple, and that is called the Kshatriya Simheshwara. The one facing west is the smaller one. It's called Rajasimheshwara. Kshatriya Simha and Rajasimha were both titles of King Narasimhavarman II, whom we fondly called Rajasimha. Now, was that Vishnu that is in the middle, sandwiched between the two Shiva sanctums, he has actually been carved on a rock there, a boulder on the seashore. He has been carved over there. And that image is said to be by many scholars of the time of Mahamalla Narasimhavarman I. And he is there, we assume, as Sthalashayana. It's very dark, we are not able to see. But then some scholars have again said that the lines of the snake have also been seen there. If the lines of the snake are seen there, then that is not Sthalashayana, that is Anantashayana. Then that cannot be the Sthalashayana Perumal temple. And this one that we see in the center of the town is the actual Sthalashayana Perumal. But this has been rebuilt so many times, and we have only inscriptions of the Sambuvarayar clan and Vijayanagara clan. We don't have earlier inscriptions, Pallava inscriptions over here. Whereas the Shore temple still has Pallava inscriptions. Everything again is a big question mark over there. I'll just conclude with two or three more images. This is the tank of the Sthalashayana Perumal temple. It's very clearly connected with a Maharishi called Pundarika Maharishi. So this tank has also got that name. And Thayar there, Goddess Lakshmi is Pundarika Valli Thayar, a lovely tank which is always full of water. And this is a Nalakal Mantapam just outside the Sthalashayana Perumal temple, today used as an auto rickshaw stand. And we'll just see this auto stand very soon. This was once how it actually looked. It's a beautiful classic four-pillared mantapa, and these are the sculptures that you will be seeing at the base of this four-pillared mantapa. And you have people doing all this here, and then slowly the road level rises and the feet of the Vishnu are missing, and then it goes up to the thigh portion gone, and then you have Garuda here submerged in concrete till the waist, and then this is the fate of another Vishnu over here, and this is the fate of Ramanujacharya or some other great Acharya who had visited this temple. And the worst of all, the unkindest cut of all, is this Narasimha, who has not only been immersed in concrete but spat upon as well. You can see that. And then the Shankha and the Chakra are there. All this happens. Kurma Avatara almost gone, and very close to this signboard that keep the town clean. You know, this is honestly very, very sad. But then this other four-pillared mantapa is safely under the care of the Archaeological Survey of India. There it is, and you can see it in all its glory. So having well and conclusively run out of time, I just want to end by saying that this is one place where you have the three different stages of temple architecture. You have the cave temple, which is cut in, you have the monoliths, which are cut out, and then you have the structural temples, shore temple you have, then the lighthouse, and then you have the Mukundanayanar temple, that's what it's called today, all of the time of Rajasimha. You also have remnants of the ancient wood tradition, where you see the rafters in the so-called Draupadi Ratha. All of it is here. You have sculptures. I haven't shown you the penance panels at all, but that is coming in a lecture subsequently. And you have portrait sculptures. Parts of Mamallapuram were also painted. Traces of paintings were noticed on the Dharmaraja Ratha. All of it is there. Everything that you need to study temple architecture, art, sculpture, inscriptions — I've hardly touched upon the inscriptions — everything is there in this one small town called Mamallapuram, our Kadal Mallai. Everything is there. We try to understand, but we are not able to understand. It is as mysterious as going into a deep forest. You don't know which side to look. It's all very enchanting. It's all very beautiful. Scholars have worked on it for decades and decades, but I don't think anybody has come to any conclusion, and nor will we. We, at some point of time, I think, try to give up trying to understand Mamallapuram and just stand back and enjoy its beauty. Thank you so much.